Now we have our final speaker for the evening, and this lecture will be entirely in English because our guest comes from the University of Amsterdam, Netherlands. So Professor Dr. Dick Schwab is an internationally recognized researcher who published hundreds of scientific papers, wrote a best-selling book, and received numerous awards, among which also the title Knight of the Order of the Netherlands Lions. So, Professor, I'm not entirely sure, should I be calling you sir or?
Yes, you can, madam.
So, please welcome, Professor. And as before, we will have 5 minutes for questions at the end of the lecture. We will be using the Slido system that you can find next to the video. You can upvote the questions you find interesting, and Professor Schwab will answer most upvoted questions at the end.
So you will select the questions?
Yes, the ones that are most upvoted. So
and the easy ones.
we'll see. So you can start now.
Okay. So I'll share the screen. It's clear?
Yes, perfect.
Okay, fine. Okay, so let me start not with criminal behavior, but at the other side, when a criminal comes to court, and then witnesses are asked their story to tell. And you can see here how we see an event with the backside of our brain first, and then the picture is analyzed for different properties. So movement is sent to this part of the brain and processed there and stored there. Colors are going temporalwards, and faces even more to the temporal lobe. And that means that all the properties of what you see and hear and smell are stored in different brain areas. And then when you come to court and the judge is asking you to tell what you have seen, you have to bring all those fragments together. And that is happening, for instance, here. And I hope that you can all see the white triangle with the points over here. Is there anybody who cannot see the white triangle?
No,
everybody is seeing. What?
It's visible, yes.
Yeah, it's visible. Okay, but it doesn't exist. It's not there. But there are spare triangles here in the black spots, and there are lines that stop at the right moment, and then the brain is making lines, which are not there. There's no line, there's no triangle. So the brain brings information together in a seemingly logical way. And that's also happening with the things we have seen in the street and the things we tell the judge. And when you see the next picture, you can see four girls, and you can swear in court, I've seen four naked girls behind the screen. But when you take the screen away, you can see that all four have a bikini. And now you know that, and I place the screen back, and they are naked again. So the brain is making a story, and the brain is making a story that seems to be logical. It's making the decision about the story at the right hand of the brain, and the left side of the brain is making the story afterwards. And it sounds logical, but it can be wrong. And all the judges know, of course, that although you swear that it happened like this, you cannot be trusted if there are not other witnesses telling the same thing. Okay, then the second part that we should know is that we have moral rules. And moral rules, some people think that we get the moral rules from our parents or from the church. But when you read Frans de Waal, and I hope you will do that, about monkey societies, then you can see that the big monkeys have the same moral rules as we have. So they have moralistic aggression, empathy, there's incest, taboo, revenge. They are ashamed for breaking the rules, and they are afraid for punishment. And those moral rules are the same because they are needed to let the society, which is very complex also by monkeys, function in the right way. So we should keep an eye on what we are doing to other people, and that is called the moral rules. That also means that since monkeys have the same building stones of moral rules, that they are hundreds of millions of years old, and that they are brought to us by our genetic background. But you should also know that in all the different aspects of the moral rules, there's variation. There's variation in all our behaviors, but also, for instance, in empathy. Some people have a lot of empathy. They take care of everybody in the world, and other people don't have empathy. They simply don't have it on a genetic base because there's variability. And this holds for all the aspects of our moral behavior. So it's genetically based. It's the same in monkeys, but it's very variable between people. Well, for the moral rules to function, you need a healthy brain. And when you look in prison with a simple scanning method, and a structural scanning method, you will find in violent prisoners, in this case, very high proportion of small alterations in the brain that have become in action during early development. There's no other explanation for that. And that means that if you look in prison, and I will repeat that with other examples, there is a lot of neurological and psychiatric problems in the prisoners. There are genes that are especially involved in aggressive behavior. This is a study from China. And you can see that in a serotonin transporter promoter, there is polymorphism. That means that there are different variants in DNA that go together with extremely violent crime in China. And this type of polymorphisms has also been found in other countries, in other prisoners. It runs in the family because it has a genetic basis, and it has a genetic basis in the variations in DNA. So we have all the same genes, but within the genes, there are small variations that make people more or less aggressive. And that is why aggression and also criminal behavior can run in families. Our IQ is genetically determined. So it's very important to select your parents. It's genetically determined for some 80%. But there are also people with a low IQ. And when I was trained in the university hospital, this picture was taken 100 years earlier, but it's the same university hospital. There were still people with short white coats, and they brought patients to their beds, and they brought the samples to the lab, and they brought the mail around, and they were making coffee and tea and talking here and there. They had an IQ between 50 and 70. But they were totally integrated in the university family of that university hospital. Well, at a certain moment, it became fashion to have all the factories and all the universities populated by young and dynamic people. And those people with a low IQ had to go into the street. They didn't have a job anymore. And since then, they adapted very well to the street, and that means to criminal behavior in the street. And when you look now, and that's not only true in the Netherlands, that's worldwide, in the population that comes to criminal court, 50% of the population has a low IQ, although this IQ is only 16% of the total population. So with a low IQ, you have a lot more risk to become criminal simply because the simple jobs have disappeared and they come into the in the streets. So we have exchanged our simple and cheap jobs for a very expensive system of judges and prisons. I said already that some 88% of our IQ is genetic, and there are more factors that determine our character that are genetic, but it's not only genetics. And you can see that from those scans, which come from an identical twin. This is one child and this is the second child. And you can see here between the P and the arrow in the middle, there are 1, 2, 3 gyri. And here between the P and the arrow, there are 1, 2, 3, 4 gyri. And that means that the brains of those identical twins are different. And that's what you also can hear from the parents. From birth onwards, one of them is crying a lot, the other has a lot of attention and is always smiling. They have different characters. And those scans, they were made immediately after birth. So it's something that is taking place in the womb during pregnancy. They have the same DNA, they are identical twins, but the brain becomes different by a system that we call self-organization. And self-organization makes our brains different. Everybody has a different brain because of self-organization. And self-organization is that the cells are looking for the best contacts. And since we have 100 billion nerve cells, and each nerve cell makes contact with between the 1,000 and 100,000 other cells, it's a tremendous amount of contacts. And only the contacts that are strong enough and taking place at the right moment in development, they stay, and the rest is disappearing. And with that, also the cells are disappearing. So it's a competition for the best contacts. And we make some 5 times more cells than we keep in our brain ultimately. And this process of self-organization makes our brains different. So it's not unique to be unique. You're all unique. Everybody is unique. Everybody has a unique brain. And then in during pregnancy in the womb, there are different factors involved for brain development. There should be enough food, and undernutrition gives permanent changes in brain function. The undernutrition can also take place because the placenta doesn't function. Chemicals that pass the placenta can influence the level of aggression. Antisocial behavior can be induced by chemicals. Hyperactivity of children, and those hyperactive children cannot inhibit their impulses, so they come often to court. Smoking of the mother during pregnancy, alcohol during pregnancy, drugs, medicines, and then all types of chemicals in the environment might have an effect on the developing brain. And you can see here a child that is born in the hunger winter last year in the Netherlands of German occupation, 1944. And this child was followed for 75 years now with the whole group of children from the hunger winter. And it appeared that they had more risk for schizophrenia, for depression, for obesity, for antisocial personality disorder, and also for addiction. And you can say, well, hunger, because there's not enough food in the environment, that's not a problem anymore in Europe. But there are still children born too light for their birth weight, for the gestation length. And you can see a child like that here in an intensive care unit for newborns. And those children have the same risks, also a higher level of aggression for the rest of their life, a higher risk to get into contact with police and justice. Alcohol taken by the mother is passing the placenta, and normally cells are formed around the ventricle and then migrating along fibers of glia cells to the cortex that is formed. But if the mother is alcohol drinking, then the cells lose their way to the cortex. And you can see here, this is a child that died shortly after birth. This part of the brain is quite normal, but here there's a white mass on top of the brain. If you take a small piece out of that, it contains nerve cells and glia cells. And that means that the cells lost their way to the cortex and they even penetrate through the membranes around the brain, and they are differentiating on top of the brain. And that's, of course, not the best place to function. And if you then go back to prison again and you look to people that were during pregnancy exposed to drinking of the mother, then they have 19 times more risk to be put in prison than children that were not exposed to alcohol during pregnancy. And then medicines like glucocorticoids, they are given when a child is probably born too early because the lungs are not mature at that moment. And they can be matured by giving the mother corticosteroids. And that's good for the lungs, but it's bad for the brain. You inhibit brain function and you inhibit brain development. And those children have a higher risk for ADHD, that is hyperactivity. And since they cannot inhibit their impulses, they come often into contact with police and justice. Sexual differentiation of the brain takes place already in the womb. There's a peak of testosterone in boys, and there is no peak in sex hormones in that period in girls. And then after birth, there's a second peak of testosterone in boys, and in girls, there's a peak in estrogens. And then it's quiet until puberty, the sex hormones go up, and they activate the circuits that are built in the early developmental period before birth. And this is important for sexual behavior. It determines our gender identity, it determines our sexual orientation, but it also determines our level of aggression. And you can see here a little boy that is aggressive. Boys are more aggressive than girls because there's that testosterone peak in early development and there's higher testosterone in puberty. But some boys are more aggressive than other boys, and that's because of polymorphisms in the receptor for testosterone or in other genes involved in aggressive behavior. The level of testosterone can change. If girls have been exposed to high testosterone because they have an inborn disease, then they are also more aggressive. Some medicines increase the level of aggression for the rest of the life of the child, and those medicines are taken by pregnant mothers. If the placenta doesn't function well or the mother is smoking, there's also a higher level of aggression in children. And from this boy, you cannot see that it's a genetically determined aggression, but if you compare his to his father, it's very clear. Then puberty starts, and the sex hormones activate the circuits that are formed earlier in development. Puberty has typical behavior aspects, and they can be very annoying, but it has an evolutionary advantage. Because when you are in puberty, you become sexually mature, and you should not get children in the same environment as your parents, because then you get an accumulation of mutations in DNA. So what should happen, that is that you start to hate your parents, you want to go on adventure, you don't make decisions on long term, only on short term. You look for adventure in your relationships, but also in compounds. And you move out of the environment of your parents. Well, that is an evolutionary advantage, but it's of course a problem for parents and for the children themselves also. It should be clear that when you look for adventure, you can also look for it in alcohol, in drugs, And quite a number of children in puberty and adolescents have come into prison. This can happen in every family. You can see here Beatrix, which was our queen. She was arrested at the age of 15 with her sister and a few girlfriends because she was stealing some free food from a shop. And then the police called the mother of Beatrix and the queen at that moment. And they said, well, this is the problem. And what should we do with your daughter? And she said, what are you going to do with the others? They said, well, we keep them here for 2 hours. And she said, well, keep my daughter for an extra 2 hours because she has to learn to give a good example. And that's indeed what you should do. You should give them punishment in puberty, but not in a way that makes the schooling for the future difficult or the training for a job difficult, because then they cannot return and they will come into criminal behavior that they learned in prison. Well, here you can see the most criminal behavior there is. This is killing of men by men. And you see here a red curve separated for age groups. And you see that killing is starting to increase in puberty when testosterone is going up. It has a peak around 23 years of age, and then it's going down. There's Chicago, there's England, there's Canada. It's all the same pattern. And here there are some curves of different groups of our country in the Netherlands. And you can see that, so they come into contact with police here. And you can see that there's also that peak around 23 years of age. The rise in criminal behavior is due to the fact that testosterone is going up. The decrease is not due to the fact that testosterone is going down, but to the fact that finally the brain is going to mature. And it's a particular part of the brain that is maturing very late. You can see that here. This is going from 5 years to 20 years of age. And you can see the red areas in the brain in different ages, which means that in that area, there is still an increase in size. And that's not because there are new cells formed, but because there are new contacts formed. And it's going even over the age of 20 years until in some 23, 25 years of age. And if you turn the brain around, you can see that this is part of the prefrontal cortex. And this is an important part for setting the moral rules and also for inhibiting the impulses. And that means that although we think that we are adult at the age of 18, and that's also the law, that in fact, the brain is only mature at the age of 23. And this is in the Netherlands the only time that politicians have listened to brain research, because now the law for young criminals is not going to 18 years, but now to 23 years of age. And that means that the judges are focusing on education and preventing criminal behavior in the future, and not in the first place for punishment. Well, if you have a brain that is not mature yet, and the prefrontal cortex that cannot very well inhibit the impulses, if you are then in a stressful situation, like in Europe now with the corona measures, and you have to stay at home, you cannot even go into the streets. Some people are getting so much stressed that cortisol, the stress hormone, is going up, and that inhibits the prefrontal cortex and the little possibilities the prefrontal cortex has in younger people is then totally inhibited, and they lose control over their behavior. And that's what you see in Europe happening. They are fighting with the police because the stress has limited their inhibitions, and they just cannot stand their impulses. Criminal behavior, aggression, is a taking place on basis of a balance between structures in the brain that stimulate aggression and structures in the brain that inhibit aggression, like the prefrontal cortex. Well, stimulation of aggression is taking place by, for instance, the amygdala. That is a structure indicated here. And this is Bull in Spain. This is Professor Delgado. And he has implanted electrodes in the amygdala of this bull. And when the bull is attacking, he is stimulating by radio the electrodes in the amygdala. And you can see that the bull stops his aggressive attack. This experiment can only go wrong once, of course, but it's a nice illustration of the importance of the amygdala for aggressive behavior. Well, this is a person, and he was stealing simple things from supermarkets and put into jail for a short period, 1 or 2 weeks, and then going again into this type of behavior. And the last time he was catched at a supermarket in the Netherlands with 10 steaks. And he didn't know what to do with 10 steaks. Nobody understood it. And that was the moment that his mother said it all started after his accident with a car. He was in coma for 1 week. And then a scan was made. And you can see the destruction in the prefrontal cortex. So there is quite a lesion in the prefrontal cortex explaining that he cannot inhibit his impulses. And if you then go back to the prison and look for the people that have repeated injuries of the brain in prison, it's 60%. It's quite a lot. So there are quite a number of reasons why your brain is not functioning well and you have a higher risk to end in prison. Sports is also dangerous in that sense. Rugby, that is American football, is known for this. It was the first time that somebody was looking into the brains of sportsmen because in America, there were famous people, famous football players that had a very aggressive type of behavior. They were molesting their wives and children. And they had depressions. They committed suicide. And after the suicide, this neuropathologist was studying the brain, and he found lesions in the brain, which were very typical. If you hit the brain a few times, you get lesions in the brain. They are stained here for a compound that's also present in Alzheimer's disease. And the four stages here give an increased number of lesions after an increased number of hits on the brain, and you can see that finally the whole brain is lesioned, and those people have a very different type of behavior, sometimes by sports lesions like boxing or American football. Also heading of football, our European football, is known to give lesions. Well, there are quite a number of brain disorders that can lead to aggressive behavior and to coming into contact with police and justice. I won't mention them all, but it's not only neurological diseases, also schizophrenia, borderline, mental retardation, I already mentioned, multiple sclerosis, dementias, and alcohol. Alcohol is one of the main reasons for fighting during the Friday evening and weekends. Well, this is an example of somebody who had schizophrenia. And Hinckley tried to kill President Reagan. And before he tried that, he made this picture of himself in front of a mirror. And his brain was going over the world as the first scan of a schizophrenic criminal. And you can see that there is quite some space between the gyri, which is normal for Alzheimer patient, for instance, but not normal for young people. This is a young person. And this is one of the signs of the atrophy and degeneration found in schizophrenia. This person has stayed in prison ever since, and there are quite a number of schizophrenic patients that have committed crimes and were kept in prison even without treatment for them. A new group of people that come into contact with police and justice are old people. There are more and more old people with a starting dementia. There are different types of dementia, and they cannot inhibit their impulses anymore. And they can suddenly, after a life without any problem, be involved in traffic accidents, in robberies, in insults, sexual inappropriate behavior, etc. And if that happens to old people, then it becomes time for a scan. And you can see here two examples of diseases. This is Alzheimer's disease. This is a control. And you can see in Alzheimer's disease, there's an atrophy. You can put your finger everywhere between the gyri. And this is frontotemporal lobe dementia. You see, the frontal lobe is degenerated, but the rest of the brain is normal. And those people are not starting with dementia. They are starting with behavior problems. And they often get into problems also in criminal court. So I think we all accept the idea that if people have an abnormal brain, that they are not responsible for their actions. And this is called the McNaughton rule. And McNaughton was a person in 1843 who wanted to kill the prime minister, but by accident he killed his secretary. And he was investigated, and he was the first one who was not sent to prison, but sent to a mental institution. And since then it's called the McNaughton rule. And the McNaughton rule has also a biological basis. I told you already that monkey societies have been studied carefully. The monkeys learn the rules because every monkey that's in the neighborhood of a young monkey that does something that is not allowed will give a hit. But this was not happening to one of the monkeys in the monkey society. And that appeared to be a monkey with Down syndrome. So also monkeys accept the rule that if you have an abnormal brain, you should not be punished for passing the rules. But nevertheless, if you go to prison, and I have been doing that in quite a number of countries, then it's full of people with a psychiatric or neurological disorder. So depending on your definition of disorders, it is some 70 to 90% that have psychiatric or neurological problems. They are often only punished and not treated. I told you about the adult law that is going up now in the Netherlands to 23. What we have seen in the Netherlands is that after a new government was selected, there were always new rules for punishment. And we have had a period of alternative punishment, so less prison punishment, more alternative ways of punishing. And then the last two governments were time after time increasing the length of punishment, increasing the severity of punishment, etc. And then when we asked the judges that had to give those punishments, do you know whether this punishment is more effective than the former punishment? They said, we don't know. It has never been studied. And that's true for over the world. It's a demand of politicians, but it's not studied. And I always try to convince the lawyers that you should test a new punishment like a new medicine. You should test it against the old punishment in a controlled way by techniques that are also used for testing new medicines. And this is hardly used in criminal court. This is how it also can go. This is one of the brothers that were famous for the playing ball in America. Those were Dutch boys, but they were playing in the Premier League in the United States. And one of them, well, they were very good friends together. And one of them got a schizophrenic period in which he killed his brother. So during a psychosis, he didn't know what he was doing, but he killed his brother. And then the judge decided that during waiting for the trial, he should go home and be treated. And the family was very much in favor of that. And after the trial, he was also said to get treatment and was not punished by prison because he had a psychosis during the period that he killed his brother. So punishment has different aspects. In the first place, it's to maintain the rules of the society. We have a complex society and it can only function if we maintain the rules. And then if we want to punish people because they don't keep to the rules, we don't do that like the monkeys all by ourselves. We have given this right to police and justice. But they should give punishment because otherwise the society is not satisfied about the situation and you get the revenge of the population itself. Well, we hope, of course, that by giving punishment that the risk for repetition of this behavior is diminished. But the problem is that this has not been studied. We don't know what the most efficient punishments are. And we should study that in evidence base. Then all politicians think that if you give higher punishments, then you prevent criminal behavior. All the studies show that this is not the case. Criminal behavior is not done within the back of the head of the criminal, how much punishment he will get for it. It's just done by impulse. There are people who have such a disturbance of brain development that they cannot be punished in the right way, they cannot be treated in the right way, and they will repeat this type of behavior without any inhibition. So the society should be protected against them. And that's what we call a long stay situation. Long stay is usually for the rest of the life of people because they are staying a threat for society. But since it is a disturbance of brain development and they didn't ask for that, they should live in a rather comfortable way in a long stay place. Well, punishment is one thing, but there's more than repression. I told you already that it's important to have jobs for people with a low IQ. People should be treated for the psychiatric and neurological disorders, for addiction, etc. The adult law should only start at the age of 24. People should be, when they have to be sent to prison, they should get schooling in prison so that they come out in prison with better chances for a job. People that have pedosexual behavior and come out of prison are usually isolated, but it's very important to have a circle of volunteers around those people that talk to them, that go once to a cinema, have a talk, because when the impulses of pedosexual behavior become strong, they have somebody to talk to. And that gives a reduction of the repetition of the behavior of 75%. So you should not isolate them. You should keep in contact with them. We have a system of TBS, and that means that if people have a psychiatric disorder and committed a crime, they can get punishment plus forced treatment of this disease. So they are obliged to be treated. And this system is unique for the Netherlands, and it gives people the chance for a good treatment. And in the course of at most 6 years, it is decided whether this is a possibility for that person, or they have to go to a long stay place. Well, what is important, of course, is the prevention of criminal behavior. There are risk groups that can be described, and when those risk groups are guided in the right way, you can prevent a lot of criminal behavior. So, for instance, poverty, single parent bringing up of children, addiction of the parents, etc. It's all risk factors for criminal behavior of the children. And when there is a good guidance of this type of families, then you can do a lot of prevention. And that's happening in big cities like Amsterdam and Rotterdam in the Netherlands. Well, I've written those books you heard about for general public, and that is because I want to tell the general public what a fantastic machine the brain is, but also how easy it can go wrong. If you know something about brain development, you are amazed that sometimes it's going well because it's so complex. There are so many opportunities to have a non-optimal brain development. And if that is taking place, of course, then you can change this in behavior, and you can get psychiatric disorders, neurological disorders, etc. It's important to make this clear to the general public, because there is an enormous taboo on psychiatric disorders and a stigma for the family. And I work also in China, and there it's clear what a taboo means, because China is, according to their formal data, a very healthy country. They have only 1/3 of the depressions we have in the Netherlands. But that's not because they are healthy. It's because the last thing you do in China is go to a psychiatrist and be treated, because that gives a stigma to the family. The children cannot marry. The people can lose their job. So they don't do that. And that results in 3 times more suicides in China than in the West. And in the Netherlands, there is still that taboo of psychiatric disorders. And I'm sure it's everywhere in Western countries present. It's important to make clear to the general public that they shouldn't be ashamed for psychiatric disorders. They should go to the right treatment facilities and get treated in an early phase before problems, like, for instance, aggressive behavior come into overtness. Well, thank you for attention. And if there are questions, please let me know.
Thank you. Thank you for this fantastic lecture. I have quite a lot of questions. So first, can epigenetic regulation cause significantly varying levels of aggressive behavior despite the same genetic basis? And how strong is the purely genetic component?
Yes, it's a very good point. It's always an interaction between the genetic background and the epigenetic factors. And I mentioned a lot of epigenetic factors already in the womb. So the amount of food and whether mother is smoking or drinking alcohol or taking drugs. And some children have a genetic background that makes them vulnerable to those factors. So then the epigenetic factors can lead to very clear behavior disorders. Other children can withstand those factors very easily because they are not vulnerable.
Thank you. Now, do you think that the higher rates of aggression in boys can be blamed mostly on genetics, or maybe we can explain it more by societal norms, culture, etc.?
It's mainly testosterone. And we know that because there are also girls that are exposed to testosterone in the WOMP because they have a congenital adrenal hyperplasia. And then we see the same aggressive type of behavior in girls as we see in young boys. And of course, in adolescents, the levels of testosterone are much higher in boys than in girls. So it is, in that sense, it's testosterone, but there are genetic factors involved in the sense of the sensitivity to testosterone. So the message of testosterone is received by a receptor, and we know some 80 polymorphisms in the receptor. So there are 80 different types of androgen receptor, and that means that some people are very sensitive to testosterone and other people are less sensitive to testosterone. So it's again, complex.
And are people who can't adapt to social norms more infantile in a way that they cannot predict consequences? And is prefrontal region responsible for that?
Well, it's not simply infantile, because some people don't have empathy. They cannot feel what they can do to other people. And those people we call psychopaths. Mm-hmm. And psychopaths are they have properties that can be used very well in some circumstances because they go straight for their goal. They don't mind what they are doing to other people. They don't feel regret. And this type of behavior, I was talking to an general and. A military general, and he was telling that he likes to have a few of those people in his group because there are situations where you need them. And the interesting thing is that you find them also in some professions, in high ranks of banks and international companies. And it often starts with reorganization. So they are very good in reorganization because they can fire 3,000 people without feeling anything. They are very efficient. They do that in an excellent way. And they do it so good that they are putting then those people into the board of the company. And there they continue with this behavior. And this was the start of the financial crisis and the bank crisis in the West. Those were all people that were just manipulating the companies and the banks in such a way that they themselves had great advantage, but they brought into danger many other people. So it's a variation in behavior due to genetic background. And those people can be used in certain jobs, but they can be very dangerous too.
Yes, when you mentioned the percentage of psychopaths in different professions, I also heard that among the doctors, the surgeons are the highest ranking and they are four times more likely to be a psychopath.
And the lowest ranking are the people in caring jobs. So the nurses, this type of people, they have the lowest ranking of psychopathy and the highest ranking of empathy.
Now, the next question you already explained a bit, but how strong are genetics? Can they be changed with psychosocial interventions and positive new experiences?
To a certain degree. And as I have shown, there is a peak of criminal behavior around the age of 23, and then it's going down. That means it's usually, criminal behavior is usually a matter of young people. And then if you look to those people at a very young age, then the efficient way to punish them is not so much prison. It's to give them alternative type of tasks, but in addition, also change the environment, the family circumstances of those people, the schooling, etc. So when you make the social situation better, and you also give some punishment to make clear that this behavior is not acceptable, then you get much better results than with prison. Because in prison, the only thing you learn is criminal behavior.
Thank you. Now, if genetics is the main determinant factor for aggression, could be the gene therapy an optimal treatment for aggression and or antisocial personality disorder?
Well, if you want to do something with gene therapy, you should change on the moment of conception. You should change the fertilized egg. Because you bring in genes as a kind of medication for the cells. But if you want to have it working, you should bring it in every brain cell, which is impossible. It's impossible. So, and in addition, of course, it's not only simply the presence of a gene, but it's a gene during brain development. And it's changing the building of the brain, and then the reaction of that brain to what's happening in the environment is different from what we call normal. And that is the big problem for psychiatry in general. It's all developmental disorders. Also depression. You are vulnerable to depression because you have the genetic background and there's something happening during early development that makes you vulnerable. And that holds for schizophrenia, that holds for aggression, addiction, for all the psychiatric problems. It is a developmental problem. And you cannot return brain development to start again. So that is the big problem of psychiatry.
Okay, then maybe one more. Aren't the people who have extremely high IQ more manipulative, even more dangerous? We can't predict their acts. So.
No, the general, well, what we see in general with very high IQ people is that they are not dangerous. They are sad. They are not doing very well in class. They feel that they don't belong to school. They have problems. And that is because they are not interested in what is brought in school. It's going too slow. They are not working on their level, on their own level. And the best thing you can do is to give them an extra task. Let them learn Chinese, for instance. Things that are really difficult. And then they become happy. Then they are in the way functioning as they want to function. So they are not dangerous in general. They are problematic kids. And there are quite a number of children that don't do well in school. But if you test them, they have an excellent IQ and a very high IQ. That's not the reason. The reason is that they are just annoyed with school.
Oh, yeah, not stimulated enough then, or?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, give them extra stimulation.
So thank you very much for first the lecture and then answering all these questions. We have more, but our time is running out. So thank you so much for coming.
Well, thank you for sharing. And hope to see you once in Ljubljana.
Yes, hopefully sometime in the future we can meet and have some type of lecture again live. Not over the computers.
Yes, I hope that that from September or so it will be possible to travel freely again in Europe. You'll see.
Thank you so much.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
Success with your studies.
Thank you.